We're here at a house that was heavily damaged by Hurricane Matthew. It experienced extensive flooding. And some of the things we're going to talk about related to this house are things that you'll find when you return to your home after flooding. Before you ever get to inside the house, though, there are a couple of things that you need to do outside the house. First thing you need to do is look at the house and make sure that it's structurally sound to enter. So you'll walk around the house and look for things like cracks, settling of the foundation, stairs that may be broken away, bricks that may have moved, columns, things like that that may be out of place. You also want to look and make sure the roof isn't sagging, that everything's okay there, that the electrical lines are not down, that there are no holes or obvious hazards outside the house that you might encounter. So one of the things you'll notice about this house is it has wall-to-wall carpeting, at least in this room and to the kitchen. And wall-to-wall carpeting is, again, very porous. It absorbed all of those things that those floodwaters carried. So if there was gas in the floodwaters, pesticides, sewage, that's all been absorbed right here in this carpet. So what we want to do with wall-to-wall carpet is we want to go ahead and pull it up and get it out of the house, as well as the padding underneath it. We don't save either the carpet or the padding. This is a stabilized situation where we're going to look at the inside of a wall. To see what happens when floodwaters actually flood a house and to see what happens behind the wall. If this were not already open and this weren't a stabilized situation, I would have my hat on, my N95 or better respirator, my goggles. I'd make sure I had gloves, long sleeves, all for my personal protection while I'm opening this particular wall. The thing to remember too, that not only does the drywall and the insulation absorb the water to the flood line, but it also wicks up. It can wick up to about a foot above where that water line was. So when you go to remove the wall so that you can dry out the studs and you can dry out the sheathing, you need to remove the drywall about a foot above where that water line was. We need to determine the moisture content of the wood before we go back and seal this wall up again with insulation and with drywall. And the way we do that is by using a moisture meter. This is a moisture meter. It has two prongs. You put it into the wood and it'll give you the moisture content of that particular piece of wood. Down below here, the moisture content is about 50%. 50% is way high. But what's interesting is if we go just slightly above it and we do a reading, it tells us we're at about 15 or 16%. So right from here above is dry. Anything 15 or below is dry enough to cover up. When you're about 19 to 15, you're getting close. Anything above 19%, we have a concern about. A lot of people have hardwood floors in their house, and hardwood floors can be salvaged, but they're kind of a special case. You can see that as they dry, they will buckle, they will warp, they'll create an uneven surface. So if you can, as it's drying, if you can every so many feet remove a board or a plank so that it dries a little flatter without the buckling and the warping, you'll do better. Once this is dry though, what you'll need to do is come back and sand it and refinish it again. So we've walked through the house and we've seen the extensive damage that a flood can do. It can ruin furniture, it can ruin flooring, it can create an extensive amount of mold all throughout the house. But the good news is the basics of the house can usually be salvaged. So even though a lot of these things will have to be taken out and discarded, you can still eventually live in this house and even save some of those things that you've had from your past. But the important thing is doing it carefully and doing it properly and taking the time to allow the house to dry.